Good afternoon and welcome to our webinar where we're going to talk through rental and mortgage assistance programs and other tools to support residents during the COVID-19 pandemic. I'm Melissa Keene. I'm a senior program manager with the Institute for Local Government, and I will be your host and moderator this afternoon. So the COVID pandemic has adversely impacted economic opportunity and the ability for California residents, many of whom were already burdened, to afford housing costs. While the pandemic has created a number of challenges, local governments have formed partnerships and explored unique strategies to help their residents stay housed. This webinar will share programs and tactics local governments have put in place, including rental assistance, tenant protection, and anti-displacement practices. So a quick overview of today's agenda. So I'm going to do this welcome and a little bit of overview about ILG. And we're going to talk about setting the stage and have a couple of polling questions for you all. And then we're going to hear presentations from all of our panelists. So Heather Vicona and Carrie Tarman will share their program called United Lift, which is helping Riverside County residents stay housed during the pandemic. Christine Vitarelli with the City of Arvin is going to share a partnership that they formed with self-help enterprises to help their city and residents access grant access grant funding. And then Marianne Leshen from the City of Oakland is going to share their program, Keeping Oakland Housed. And then we will definitely have some time for Q&A at the end, and then we're going to share some information about some additional upcoming webinars and then wrap up by 3 p.m. So you've probably noticed that you are muted and will be muted for the duration of the webinar, but that doesn't mean you can't ask us questions. So you should see a questions box on the right-hand control panel of your screen. And you can type in questions to us at any point during the webinar. So we'll be tracking all of those on the back end, and we'll get to as many as possible in the time held for Q&A towards the end. So a little bit of information about ILG, in case you aren't very familiar with us. We are the nonprofit training and education affiliate of the California Special Districts Association, the League of California Cities, and the California State Association of Counties. We provide practical and easy-to-use resources so that local agencies can effectively implement policies on the ground. We focus on a number of different areas. We have programs focused on leadership and governance, civics education and workforce, public engagement, and sustainable communities. And again, we provide services through education and training, like this webinar, on-the-ground technical assistance and capacity building, and then a number of convening services as well for our local government partners. So again, today's presenters are Heather Vicona, President and CEO of Lift to Rise, Carrie Harmon, Assistant Director with Riverside County Housing, Homelessness Prevention, and Workforce Solutions, Christine Vitarelli, a Grants Manager with the City of Arvin, and Marianne Leshen, Deputy Director of Housing and Community Development with the City of Oakland. Before we jump into the presentations, we're also hoping to hear a little bit about who is joining us on the line today. So I have two quick polling questions that I'm hoping you all will respond to give us a little bit of information about you. So hopefully you saw that polling question just pop up on your screen, and we're curious if you are an elected official, if a city manager or county administrator, if you're with a local agency staff, or other. We'll give you just another minute or so to respond. Okay, I'm going to close that and share. And so it looks like the vast majority of you are staff with a local agency. So one quick follow-up question. So for those of you that were other in that last category, where this hopefully will give you a little bit more information, give us a little bit more information. So are you, again, with a local government agency or a state agency, nonprofit, or perhaps a consulting firm? close this one and we'll share these results really quickly. So not surprisingly, the vast majority of you are with the city, county, or special district, and it looks like a lot of you that probably marked other in the last poll are with nonprofit agencies. So thank you for sharing that. That helps us know who we're talking to today and what kind of questions we might get. So just wanted to also provide you a little bit of background about how ILG fits into this work and housing and what resources we're offering and how we might be helpful to you all. So we are part of the statewide housing technical assistance program. And so we're working with regions to develop technical assistance plans in coordination with HCD and PlaceWorks to really provide that regional-based technical assistance that you might need specific to your area and really meet you where you are. In addition to that, we're working with a small group of folks to update our Planning Commissioner's Handbook, which is one of our flagship resources at ILG that really covers a lot of the information that planning commissioners need to know when they get on board. And then we will be also offering some companion training on that front. And then lastly, we are also doing local leader training, which is what this webinar is part of today. So this is a part of a series that we're putting on, and we'll share some more information at the end of the webinar about the other opportunities that are coming up in this space. So with that, I'm going to turn it over to Carrie and Heather, who are going to share about United Lift. Carrie?
Well, good afternoon, everybody. It is really a pleasure to be here. Housing is, I think, one of my greatest passions, and it's a great opportunity to be able to share what we've been working on in partnership with Lift to Rise. The next slide. So we launched the United Lift Rental Assistance Program back in June, but I think that to fully set the stage, I should share with you all that our partnership with Lift to Rise on the housing front actually began over 7 years ago. Heather and I met in the desert and we're working on some food insecurity issues. And then as our relationship developed and the county partnership with Lift to Rise, we began to focus acutely on housing as the primary need and that we needed to tackle to stabilize our low-income residents. So through those efforts, we basically stood up a public-private partnership to address the needs of rent burdened low-income renters across the Coachella Valley with the goal of producing 10,000 housing units over a 10-year period. And before I say that, as I know many of you are working at the county level or the city level, and before our partnership with Lift to Rise, we tended to address affordable housing only from the county and government perspective. When we did partner with nonprofits or with the community at large, it was in a funding relationship as we did something project by project or addressed advocacy groups. But we had never carried together jointly with the private sector the need to deliver affordable housing at scale. So to produce 10,000 housing units and to do it in partnership with the private sector was something that was very radical at the time and something that we believe is part of the inherent solution to addressing affordable housing throughout Riverside County. So next slide. In June, we immediately went to our board and asked for an allocation of CARES funding. We allocated $22 million of our CARES Act and dispersed that to nearly 6,000 households countywide. Lift to Rise is the agency we use to deploy this in the eastern portion of the county, and we use United Way, which is a more traditional actor in rental assistance in our western and southwestern portion of the county. So we didn't provide any direct assistance, and we would not have been able to go to the board of supervisors in June and push that money out so quickly if we had not had that seven-year relationship with United Lift, because the relationship, the contracting, the investment, and also Lift to Rise had already demonstrated success, was already there. And I really encourage my partners on the public side to think about housing relationships long-term, what the long-term strategy is, because it really plays an important piece in emergency response. So when we exhausted all of our CARES money in December, we allocated another $9 million of CDBG funding. And of course, any of you who are experienced with CDBG, it's very cumbersome with rules and regulations. So we deployed that. And then in February, we went back to our Board of Supervisors, who was already very confident in this partnership and the results that we were obtaining at the resident level. And we were able to allocate $57 million in ARPA funding. So that was in February 2021. We're thick in the midst of it. And I should add that everything we've been working on has been deeply rooted in data and being able to report back to the Board of Supervisors what households we're serving and what the unique characteristics of those, that renter population in need is. Next slide. So our key learnings so far have been that residents know best what they need. And I think that's why it's so important to have a private partner stand beside you who's very connected to the community, because oftentimes at the government level, we think we know what is needed, but we don't actually have the feedback loop to know what our community members are experiencing at the ground. We don't provide direct services in the same manner as the nonprofits. We don't employ staff who are from the community. Like, there's tons of new grads who grew up in the Eastern Coachella Valley who are employed by Lift to Rise. So I think that rooting it in what residents needed and what residents needed now is imperative to addressing the COVID recovery. It's also important to have a flexible, unrestricted resources to facilitate partnerships. And CDBG became very cumbersome. I know it's in a variety of programs it is, but the stimulus money wasn't. And the flexibility in that funding really facilitated the partnership. I've already spoken to this, but I cannot stress it enough that existing partnerships with deep trust are really crucial to effective response in a crisis where it's changing every month. If there's been one constant in the COVID pandemic, it has been change. And to manage that, there has to be relationships where there's a strong belief and commitment to the same outcomes and the same basic values. And finally, before I pass it off to Heather, in order to tackle big things, we absolutely need a public-private partnerships. And I don't think we're gonna solve for housing long-term or short-term in California without a public-private partnership model. It is what we're championing in our work with Lift to Rise. It is how we are envisioning addressing housing across the county. And I will turn it over to Heather with that to share for the private perspective.
Thank you, Carrie. Could we go back to the timeline slide really quick, and then we'll skip back forward. So hi, everyone. As we look at this slide, first I'll just say I'm Heather Vicona. I'm the CEO of Lift to Rise, and really thrilled to be able to talk about the work that we get to do with the county in providing emergency rental assistance this year. And just one thing to say as a start is Lift to Rise is the backbone of a collective impact organization that shares a housing and economic opportunity agenda with the County of Riverside and all nine cities in the Coachella Valley. Normally, we are not a programmatic organization. So we work on policy and investment and systems change with the county. We're normally not programmatic. But actually, Carrie and I were on a flight back from the Department of Finance last March and scratched on the back of a sheet of paper what might we do in order to support residents, as in the Coachella Valley, where we are in Riverside County, we're so heavily reliant on tourism and agriculture and other sectors that were immediately impacted by COVID. So the first thing that we started to do, even before June, is we propped up an emergency cash assistance assistance program. That allowed us really quickly in the period of a month, we cobbled together a couple million dollars and we dispersed cash payments to 5,000 households. That gave us a little bit of infrastructure and trust for Carrie and her colleagues to be able to work with the Board of Supervisors to show that we have the capacity to stand something up that would be able to work countywide. So if you look at this timeline and see, I think the really remarkable thing that we've done together with the county and Carrie and her colleagues' leadership is to continue to push for resources and then together with partners, so other funders and other community orgs, to braid resources across this whole entire timeline so that we can flexibly get resources out. We often say that sometimes we feel like we're triaging oxygen because of the level of need in the population. But as everyone knows on the call, there's tons of guidelines with each of these programs. The guidelines aren't the same. And it often feels like you're trying to thread a needle with rope. And so we've been able to do this, like Carrie said, by staying in constant contact with each other and deep trust, but by sharing a platform. If we could go forward to the data learning slide, then I'll keep talking from there. So here's just a little bit more data about what's happened across the year. With that initial allocation of CARES Act funding, almost 7,000 households were served. To date, we're past 10,000 households across the entire county. And so that includes CARES Act funding, CDBG funding, and we have more than $11 million on the street already of ERAP funding. So when we think about it internally, we feel the constant pressure of trying to move faster to make sure that residents get what they need. But the county and together ourselves with Inland SoCal United Way, we have really worked at pace to get resources out quickly. The other thing that we'll just offer is that Carrie offered before the importance of listening to residents. One thing that we heard unanimously was that we really needed to be out in the community for folks to apply. So folks can see our rental assistance portal at unitedlift.org. That's the central place where folks are able to apply, but we've really made a massive outreach effort so that we show up as pop-ups across our community so that folks are able to apply. And I'll wrap up really quickly, but just here this data shows one of the things that we care about the most is making sure that rental assistance is getting to hard to reach communities. And we see an overrepresentation of communities of color, both in folks who apply and folks who are funded. And that's really just confirming what we all know, that communities of color are disproportionately impacted. But we've really centered and prioritized making sure that we're getting resources out to the community in an equitable way. And then we just have one more slide that shows, if we could go to the next slide. Yeah, this just shows a little bit of what I talked about, the disproportionate impact to communities of color. Also just seeing the number of folks that are faced with eviction and more funding coming through. The most recent federal stimulus, what we really see is even though the guidelines allow us to pay 12 months rent back, nobody is 12 months rent behind in rent. Folks and families are coping in all kinds of crazy ways to be able to stay housed. And so as we continue to work across this year, what we're really trying to think about is what's the most efficient way to use resources to make sure that we're not asking folks to jump through hoops and that we get to folks in a way that they actually need it. So all the information that we've shared today, and I know that we sort of blazed through, but all of the information is on our website, unitedlift.org. We've done monthly data reports where we analyze who's applying, what's happening in their household. It's not going to be a news flash to anybody. 45% of applicants are single parents, 89% of single parents are single mothers. So all of this just really underscoring what Carrie offered at the start, that we see that as we're sort of swimming our way through this, we must work on long-term permanent solutions to radically increase the supply of housing, because we simply just don't have enough. And that's the precarity that we see folks really facing. So with that, I think we'll finish, but happy to answer any questions later on that folks might have.
Great, thank you so much, Heather and Carrie. I'll quickly put this up, but I also have contact information for everybody at the end of the slide deck. And just a quick note, we will make sure to share not only the slide deck, but all of the links to these programs that are being discussed today in the follow-up email, so you guys can access more information that way as well. And then just a quick note to everybody on the line, please feel free to drop questions in at any point in time in the questions box, and we are monitoring that, and we'll get to them during the Q&A portion. So with that, I'm going to turn it over to Christine with the City of Arvin to talk about some of their efforts. Christine?
Good afternoon, everybody. Heather, those were some quite impressive numbers there. Sounds like a really successful program. So I'm representing the City of Arvin, and we have a collaborative effort going on with self-help enterprises for several programs that are assisting our community members. Next slide, please. One of the things to consider in a partnership is that with small disadvantaged communities, you just may not have the staff to support some of these programs, such as our community in Arvin. The staff members wear many hats, and we're very short staffed. And the only way for us to roll out these type of programs is through a collaborative effort with other organizations. So for the PLHA program, we collaborated with Self-Help Enterprises, and that was able to utilize funding to provide eligible income households with rental and mortgage assistance. And that was in the, you know, the very beginning, early stages before the ERAP program rolled out. And for our PLHA program, the first year is for rental and mortgage assistance, and the second year is going to be used to help households fund accessory dwelling units. In Arvin in particular, we have a lot of homes where they may have converted a garage space to a living area out of necessity, and we hope to provide funds in years 2 through 5 from the PLHA program to support funding for bringing those ADUs into code and to establish some programs where we have pre-approved templates for ADUs that will help our residents be able to look at and follow so that it's already pre-approved and the planning and processing goes a lot quicker. Next slide, please. So when considering this, especially for small cities such as ours, and I'm sure there's a lot out there that are disadvantaged, lack funding, and don't have the capacity to just implement these programs by themselves, it's also important to consider creative layering of funding and planning to solve problems ahead of time. So what we did is we applied for local early action planning, the LEAP grant, Local Early Action Planning Grant, to establish an ADU pre-approved design and speed up the permitting process. So that way residents could come into our planning department and have an option of ADU plans ahead of time and be approved to move forward. And then after that, we also applied for the PLHA program for allowing them funds to access this planning program. Next slide, please. And ultimately, the result of that in the following years will be that we are able to fund ADUs successfully in our community and not only have these new rules that you have to have a type A ADU or type B ADU, but that they actually have a template that they can follow and be able to be pre-approved, and that we're using HCD funds to actually help fund those improvements. So it's a win-win situation. It's creative, but sometimes you have to do that when you're in a small community with limited funding. Next slide, please. We also partnered with Self-Help Enterprises for the rollout of the HCD CV1 program. And we are using it for subsistence. Initially, we were using it for rental and mortgage assistance. And now that has transferred to mortgage assistance and utility payments with the rollout of the ERAP. But it was successful. We were able to support several households in Arvin and gave them emergency support. And now they have that option if they have a mortgage, they need help with mortgage payments or utilities, and it's up to 6 months with an AMI at 80% of AMI or below. Next slide, please. So here's just some examples of our CV1 rollout flyers. And this was the first one that included rental assistance and mortgage assistance and utility assistance. Next slide, please. And then when the ERAP program rolled out, we had to real quick change the program and make sure that we were assisting residents for mortgage assistance and subsistence payments that were not rental assistance. And Arvin is primarily Hispanic, so all of our materials were sent out in English and Spanish to help our residents. I believe it's something like 68% of our residents do not speak English at all. So it was very helpful to us. And these are great programs. Next slide, please. So in close up, when considering some of the problems and challenges you might have as a small community, it's important to consider using and working with other organizations that can help you, especially if you're a small community. We don't know everything about everything, and in certain programs such as rental and mortgage where there's substantial fiduciary duties, I found that self-help was extremely helpful in facilitating the program. And also if you are doing a collaborative program with a nonprofit, very, very helpful, because nonprofits may not always be familiar with the federal overlay rules. And we are doing a great job collaborating with self-help enterprises, and they are basically facilitating all of the federal overlays to make sure that we're doing everything exactly the way we need to. And that is very helpful for a community with a small staff of Arvin city people to assist. And so it was very, very helpful for us. And I highly recommend, when you're getting into these federal programs and state programs, if you don't have the full capacity to implement them, to collaborate with organizations such as Self-Help. And that's about it. Thank you.
Great. Thank you so much, Christine. Really appreciate your perspective coming from a smaller community in California, and how you all navigated this and are using partnerships to help build your capacity. One more quick reminder for the audience to please feel free to type any questions you have into the questions box, and we will keep monitoring that and get to them at the close of the webinar. Next up, I'm going to turn it over to Mary Ann with the City of Oakland.
Good afternoon. Thanks so much. My name is Mary Ann Leshin with the City of Oakland, and I'll get right to it. And I believe that several of the slides and the comments I'll be making are actually reinforced by the comments of the two speakers before me. I'm going to focus this presentation on our emergency rental assistance program, which we call Keep Oakland Hest. Next slide. The City of Oakland is a direct allocatee from the U.S. Treasury for the second stimulus package of emergency rental assistance program funding. We received $12.8 million directly to the city earlier this year. And as mentioned, we're deploying these funds through our program model that we call Keep Oakland Housed. The program model is similar to the speakers before me, based on our partnership with nonprofits. And the four nonprofit partners that are a part of this effort are listed below: Bay Area Community Services, Catholic Charities, Centro Legal de la Raza, and Eviction Defense Center. And what you'll see there are two of the agencies are focused on services, two on legal services, and but all together they are doing an excellent job in delivering this critical financial assistance to people most in need. And we're hoping later this spring, maybe, probably right before the summer hits, we'll be hoping to add some additional community-based partners to this network. Next slide. Our program goal is pretty simply put that we are, we've designed the program to serve the most vulnerable tenants, focused on housing stability, homelessness prevention, and preventing displacement. Next slide. Our prioritization consists of serving households at 30% of area median income or below, targeting households who previously experienced homelessness, as that's a predictor of future homelessness. We're targeting households that reside in zip codes with high rates of COVID-19 infection using data from our county housing, our county health department. And other priorities include seniors, family with children under the age of 18, and households with a member with disabilities. The use of funds, for those of you familiar with ERAP, this is probably, written on a piece of paper or on your hand, or it's already embedded in your brain. These are the uses of funds, rent arrears. We can pay for prospective rents and will pay for prospective rents up to 3 months. Utilities, and of course, all the funding goes to the property owner or the utility provider. And in the case of our program, we are limiting funds to $15,000 per household. Next slide. The City of Oakland utilizes a very intentional race and equity lens in all of its work. We actually have a Department of Race and Equity, and some of the ways in which that's done and reflected in this program is through very robust public outreach campaign for this program. Immigration status or documentation would be requested or required. We are happy to be accepting inclusive documentation such as self-declarations. Our provider agencies all can provide support in multiple languages, and our intake applications both online and on paper are available in multiple languages. As noted before, we're serving an extremely low income population and also targeting those zip codes with experiencing severe COVID-19 impacts. And next slide. What this slide does is kind of break down for us in the City of Oakland, and I don't know if this will resonate with other jurisdictions, but we're kind of caught a little bit in the crosshairs of, number one, being a city with a direct allocation from the feds, number two, running our own program separate and apart from the state that runs its SB 91 program, as you all know, and thirdly, we're residing in a county that has its own program. So this deck we use for our community outreach presentations, and I left this slide in here just to kind of paint that picture if it's helpful to anybody to see how we are differentiating ourselves from the state program, which is primarily based on the AMI levels. So we are serving tenants below 30% of AMI, and the state program is taking tenants above 30% of AMI. It had previously been 50%, but because the influx of applications at 30% was so high, we are actually, as of tomorrow, switching it to 30%. And then, of course, we have the final right-hand column reflecting that while residents of Oakland live in Alameda County, they are not able to apply to Alameda County. They have these two other program opportunities available to them. And the next slide. So basically, our program launched on April 1st. We have information available on all the different websites, the city, and our Keep Oakland House partners. To date, we've received over 1,800 applications. And interestingly, the average request so far is $7,700 per household. We are using a portal and database that's been created by one of the partner agencies. It is an excellent tool for both the intake process, scoring to create prioritization, as well as then most importantly, generating data. So very shortly, we'll be able to create the same kind of bar graphs and pie charts and whatnot that we saw from our friends in Riverside County. And I can't wait till I can do that publicly, but we're getting there. We're about a step away from being able to depict the utilization of the program in that manner. But I can say that the overwhelming majority of the applicants are meeting the priorities and, you know, from the standpoint of AMI levels, where they live, and predominantly African-American and Latino households. While we've set a program goal to expend all our funds by March 31st, even though the federal guidelines state we can go till September, I actually think we'll be expending those funds much sooner, just based on the demand and the interest levels that we've seen thus far. Next slide. I also wanted to share kind of as a bit of a bookend, and I probably could share one more that there's not a slide about, to, you know, other things that we're doing. And this is reflective of some of what was described by the two other speakers in terms of tapping into other sources of funds. So the City of Oakland's actually been running what we call our ANDI displacement program since 2018, using local funds from our Affordable Housing Trust Fund. And we call that program Oakland Housing Secure. And it has primarily been focused on eviction prevention and eviction defense, the kind of core set of services being legal services, with small emergency financial assistance grants available, up to $6,000 per household. And then this past year, we've added a social services component to that. With the COVID-19 health pandemic, of course, as well as the fact that the City of Oakland has quite a strong eviction moratorium, the focus has been on more squarely on COVID relief efforts. But we continue to operate that program and look forward to continuing it into the future. Another bookend that I would mention is we did also, as the other speakers, use CARES Act funds to provide a one-time form of rental assistance last fall. We served about 1,050 households, both renters and homeowners who were impacted by COVID with that influx of CARES Act dollars. Next slide. And this is us. This is our contact information if anybody's local and wants to check us out. This is both our City of Oakland website with information about the program, as well as the address for the portal for applications. And that is my presentation, and look forward to answering any questions.
Great. Thank you so much, Mary Ann. And as promised, we actually have quite a bit of time still left to do some Q&A. And so we do have a few questions that have already come in. But again, if you have any questions as we go through this process or anything you think of, please feel free to type things into the questions box. Let me look through these. So Heather, you talked about outreach for United Lift and how you were doing that. Could you share a little bit more about your outreach strategy, particularly as it relates to the pop-up events? And I'm guessing this is probably, how did you manage to do that in a pandemic, and what did that look like?
Sure, thank you. Yeah, that's a great question. We actually first asked the county for permission if we would be allowed to, and how we could do it in a way that was COVID safe. This is one place also where some of our other partners and other funders who stepped in were super helpful. We scheduled, I think we did 28 pop-ups during CARES Act. And essentially what we did is just, we bought pop-up tents and a ton of PPE and protective gear. We, looking at data, defined the places where we knew that. So one thing that I don't think we shared in the slide deck is because in real time we're able to analyze the data, we're able to see the barriers that folks have to applying. And in the first round, there were several thousand applicants when it got to the point of needing to upload documents, the applications trailed off. And so what that said to us is that because we have limited broadband access in some of our rural communities, that we needed to make sure, and I'm sure everyone who is working on a rental assistance program can understand, the amount of documentation that has to go back and forth between the folks processing the applications, landlords, tenants, and then there's already a pretty like vulnerable relationship, right? Because folks are stressed out, they need to pay their rent, they need to stay in their home. Also, folks are facing all kinds of other uncertainties. We scheduled pop-ups on a Wednesday and a Saturday. So in the same community, we would heavily advertise through local networks, flyering and doing outreach with partner community orgs at things like food distributions, so that folks knew that they could come down on a Wednesday, bring us all their information. Hopefully, if they had everything, get their application in and process really quickly, but then would also know like, hey, if I need this one thing that I didn't bring, I can come back on Saturday and I can give it to you. So we did that almost 30 times during the first round. What we've done during ERAP is we're continuing to do the same thing, but we've also identified two partner orgs, one in the Eastern Coachella Valley, Galilee. It's a farm worker resource center. They're open every single day, so they're an application site for us, and they are processing applications if folks need help or technology. And then in the western end of the valley in Palm Springs, DAP Health is open every single day as well. So both through, I think, communications, community partnerships, but really through data and working together with the county to make the pop-up safe. But it's really been like an all hands on deck kind of thing. The school districts have given us staff. We've just done everything we can to make sure that folks have somewhere to actually apply, because I think combined with this is the stress and tension around the eviction moratoria and folks being super confused about like, do I have to get my rent paid right now or am I going to lose my home? So fingers crossed, to date we haven't had any health scares in doing so, but we found it a really effective way to make sure that folks are able to get their applications in.
Great, thank you so much Heather. You're finding even additional partnership opportunities to conduct outreach and then making sure that's informed by the data you're getting. So that's a great approach. Appreciate your thoughts there. Similar question, I think, Christine, for you. You obviously shared some flyers about how you were sharing the information with your residents. Any other outreach strategies or tips that you all used in Arvin to spread the word with your community? Oh, Christine, I think you're muted.
Sorry about that. One of the things that was extremely helpful is we all know who our community organizations are, and we reached out to all of the community organizations in Arvin, Dolores Huerta Foundation, CRPE, Leadership Council, Community for a Better Arvin. And we also sent these flyers out and information out directly to them, because a lot of those groups have meetings and they know who to reach out to in the community. So that was extremely helpful. And it's very important to do that, because no one knows your community members better than the organizations within the community. And that was extremely helpful, just to send them flyers, send them updates, ask them to contact us, and then also refer them directly to self-help enterprises. Another challenge was the language barrier. And in that case, we made sure we had people who spoke both Spanish and English fluently to actually process the applications. But I love Heather's idea about the pop-up. I think that would be a great opportunity if we could do it in Arvin. And I'm going to propose that to our city management. But the issue for Arvin is that our COVID rates between Arvin and Lamont are 28.1%, and the state average is only 3%. So there's still some significant dangers there, which we hope those numbers will go down with the new vaccination protocols.
Perfect. Thank you so much, Christine. Appreciate the additional thoughts there. I think everybody, we're hearing this from local governments statewide, is people are still struggling to do this engagement in a virtual environment, and how do you really connect with the folks in your community. So appreciate all of the thoughts on how you all are navigating this. Marianne, a question for you. So you kind of related to the conversation we've just been having. You mentioned that you're working with your Office of Equity. Can you say a little bit more about how you are ensuring that the program is reaching your most vulnerable residents and really providing what they need?
Sure, thanks for that. Right, well, it really boils down to two things. One is where we do our outreach, how we do our outreach, and two is the prioritization. So we've been working with them on sort of the review of our data and analyzing the data and what it's telling us. I'd say, you know, on some level, there aren't a lot of surprises because this sort of disproportionate impact that COVID has had on communities of color is, you know, sort of been widely, you know, reported and analyzed, but certainly in the city of Oakland, that's what we're finding. So we've been working with them on taking a look at those numbers. That's where we came to the 30%, you know, targeting. And then on the outreach, we're working with them to identify the right pathways. So, you know, we've been starting off with a lot of the virtual presentations due to COVID, and many of our outreach team members are actually, you know, not able to get out in the community. But we're looking in our next phase to do to utilize and tap into the community organizations that have kind of community ambassadors and messengers that are doing both door-to-door and street corner type work. And so, you know, it's been in collaboration with that department that we've identified those groups, and we'll be utilizing them to kind of be sending the message to ensure full access to the program.
Great, thank you so much. Heather and Carrie, there's kind of a two-part question here. So the first question, is if the program is ongoing. So is United Lift still running? And then kind of the second part of that would be kind of looking into the longer term. And I think this could be for any of our panelists. Obviously, a lot of these programs are meeting a very immediate, very important need for residents. But any thoughts on longer term provision of, you know, rental assistance or anything like that? I know Marianne, you might be able to speak to that too. You have some ongoing programs. So first question, is United Lift still running? Are there still funds available for residents? And then we can get into the longer term question.
So there is still funding available, although if the applications that we've received about 5,000 applications, and if they all meet eligibility, we could very well, very quickly get to expending all the funds that we currently have allocated. But there's yet another iteration of federal rental assistance coming, and so that will prolong the program. I think long term, that what we've realized is we need to have a comprehensive rental assistance program built into the housing infrastructure long term that is more robust than the small scale like emergency food and shelter program or even some of the community development block grant funded rental assistance programs that just couldn't get to scale. What I do think we have gotten at, we have been successful, you know, whether it's in Riverside County or Oakland, is getting to scale because of just the dollars that have been made available at the federal level. And we need to do that kind of permanently. So building that in long term.
Great, thank you so much. Sorry, go ahead, Heather.
Oh, no, sorry. I was just gonna echo what Carrie said. I think, you know, Carrie mentioned at the top that our long-term work with Riverside County is really about creating a permanent investment vehicle to radically increase the supply of housing. And we kind of say this to ourselves all the time, that we want to radically increase the supply of housing, but we also want to make sure that our neighbors stay housed while we're trying to do that. So this question of what does it mean to carry a pool of permanent protections? And then also, you know, just from a practical standpoint, when folks look at the timeline of all the funding that we've braided across the year, we've staffed up at Lift Your Eyes. We have an additional 30 staff just in the last year working on rental assistance. And so it's constantly kind of skating the ice to be like, okay, what's coming next? And like, how do we both like land resources and how do we get out of like triage mode and begin to sort of push and use the resources possibly with ARPA to be thinking about longer term solutions, like Carrie mentioned, so that we do have more permanent solutions that are targeted and that are just past crisis response, but just reflecting what's happening just really permanently in the ecosystem and the precarity that renters are facing.
Great, thank you so much. Marianne or Christine, anything you want to add to longer term solutions or thought process?
Yeah, I'd say when the city started this work in 2018, it was in response to just high levels of displacement that were happening in our community. This was pre-COVID, and it was great that there was some infrastructure already built that we could use as the platform for the rental assistance. But as everybody's been mentioning, it's been complete. It's just a huge, intense ramp up with, it's hard to find time to think. Every day is a triage, every minute of every day feels like triage. But the one thing I wanted to share that's really, very promising for us in the Bay Area is a group called All Home California has been created about a year ago to tackle a couple of issues. And one of them is to create a regional platform and collaborative around homelessness prevention. And they were actually the group that supported our nonprofit partner in building out the data platform I was describing. So, on some level, we've had to kind of put the planning piece a little bit on hold while we just, move money quickly and, looking forward to ERAP 2, but that is on our radar and on our horizon. And we look forward to doing that in a collaborative way with our, partners, both within our county and adjacent counties, to keep, and then to look at the, all the different threads of sources, including philanthropy. We have, and I didn't mention that, we have had a, fair amount of philanthropic resources in the past going to this work as well. But, pulling together the philanthropy, the local government, the federal government, et cetera, is the direction we're headed in.
Perfect. Thank you. Christine, did you have anything to add?
Well, I think Arvin's approaching the ADU principle and trying to develop more conceptual homes, tiny homes, things of that nature. And we're hoping to put forth an affordable housing project soon so that it's not just a choice of single family homes, but other alternatives. And I'm very curious also about like a mobile home project in Arvin to try to help out people who need some kind of shelter at home resources, but it not a full single family home. So I'm trying to think of things like that. And I definitely agree with the panelists' points that I think we are really looking at a future of potentially funding rental and mortgages on a long-term basis, because the impact of COVID-19 is not just going to go away when the state opens up, and it's impacted people so differently, depending on their occupation and depending on the type of work they do. And then you also have the COVID long haulers who, may still be suffering long-term effects and can't work a full-time job. So I think it's something to consider. And I 100% agree with Marianne's focus on philanthropy. It's very important. We need to do more for our communities.
Great. Thank you all. It sounds like a lot of different approaches. So potentially continuing some of these assistance programs and looking at how to scale them and continue them post-pandemic, but also looking to address some of the housing shortage needs. And so continuing to build housing, as well as look at different types of housing, to Christine's point, not just continuing to build single family homes, but maybe multifamily establishments or mobile homes or ADUs or other types of housing to really meet the needs of your communities. So we are just about out of time. We've got about 3 more minutes, and I've got a couple of closing slides. So thank you all for your thoughts on that and all of the different questions that we've had come through. And apologies to our audience members if we didn't get to your question. Feel free to follow up with us afterwards, and we can try to direct you into the right place there. just want to share some additional opportunities for training coming up from ILG. So as I mentioned at the outset, this is part of a series that we're hosting. So we're doing them monthly. They are the first Thursday of every month. And you see the topics there on the right-hand side of your screen are the next topics we'll be addressing. So in June, we're going to be talking about effective leadership. And then we're going to be talking about public engagement. We're also going to be talking about fair housing and equity, climate resilient land use policies, and then also talking about housing strategies to help address the homelessness crisis, which we touched on a little bit today as well. But all of these are free for all of our local governments and nonprofit partners and friends. So feel free to check them out on our website and register as you are interested. Also just want to put this up and let you know to stay connected with ILG if you are interested in upcoming webinars or other trainings that we're doing. Follow us on social media or sign up for our monthly newsletter is a great way to stay connected with us and what we're doing. And then finally, just I'm going to share emails in case you need to follow up with me or any of the panelists on the line. But I hope that you join me in not only thanking our attendees, but thanking our panelists for providing their expertise and experience in these very complex, very important topics. So Heather, Carrie, Christine, Marianne, any final thoughts or comments before we close out?
No. No, thank you, everyone.
Thank you so much for the opportunity.
Thank you.
All right. Thank you, everybody, and I hope you have a great rest of your afternoon.
Thank you.